Very good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies for today's meeting. Our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda item 3 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So moving on to our next item of business, we are going to hear from two panels as part of our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. In the last weeks, we've held evidence sessions on issues around childcare. The focus of our first panel today is the provision of education and training. Barriers to accessing education and training was a strong theme in our recent call for views, and such barriers can in turn prevent access to the workplace and work progression. I welcome to the meeting our first panel, Kenny Anderson, Director, SWOP West, Keith Robson, Senior Public Affairs Manager, The Open University and representing Universities Scotland, and they are joining us in the room. And we have Sharon McIntyre, Head of SEAG Operations, Skills Development Scotland, and Jackie Galbraith, Principal and Chief Executive Officer of West Lothian College and representing Colleges Scotland, who are joining us remotely. So I thank you all and we're delighted to have you here. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. Virtual witnesses and members, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans if you wish to come in on a question. Don't feel you have to answer every single question, and if you have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's perfectly okay. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? So I invite members to ask questions in turn as agreed in our brief. So the first one I believe that's up is Katie.
Thank you. And I'd like to ask about the role of lifelong learning and what you think the role of lifelong learning is in addressing child poverty, and whether you think there's an overlap with a just transition to net zero and training people for green jobs. So there's obviously quite a lot of different parts of that. And I don't know if either of the witnesses in the room would like to respond first.
Good morning. Thank you for the invitation to come along today. University of Scotland, I think, in our submission, gave some evidence around the importance of lifelong learning and the opportunities to students. In terms of poverty, it improves the ability to gain employment, to progress in employment, to provide for families. I know that at Open University, we've got a wealth of anecdotal feedback from students and saying they wanted to be a positive role model for their children, wanted to show them that they could study and work. 74% of our students are working whilst they study with us. But across the sector, we've got universities have a positive role to play. Now, net and just transition and is obviously an area which needs developed. Of the 19 universities, there'll be different institutions playing different roles. Some up in the northeast, others will have different courses. I think different previous committees have highlighted that on a high level, we're very good talking about the need for just transition and green jobs, but actually what that means, so a clearer definition. So we can make sure that the curricula is correct and we look at supporting people through, whether it be through access courses, getting into university or colleges for the first time, gaining that confidence and making sure there's a pathway so that you can be on the right course for the right jobs and support their families.
Yeah, if I can come in as well now, convener, on that. Within the Scottish Wider Access Programme, I think I take a slightly different perspective, which is the perspective from the students who we work for, and they're mainly students with no or few qualifications. So the opportunity to return back to education is their main point of learning. Because they have no or few qualification, often their kind of formal time at education when they were younger was perhaps not as successful as they would have wanted it to be. So having those opportunities within the system to return back to education is kind of key to them. So they see it from that perspective as their chance to get back into education and to take those opportunities. I think that's linked very clearly to poverty, because those that haven't done well out of education are often those who are residing within those social and economic areas of disadvantage. And the fact that they are looking for education to be part of their solution in order to return back to education, something that I think we as a society and a system should be very much encouraging. Most of our students are looking to return back to education to gain a really good degree that's going to give them good employment in the future. And I think the challenge for us across the board is actually making those jobs of the future visible and attractive to people when they're returning back. Currently, when we speak to our students about the type of jobs that they're interested in returning back and studying and why they're wanting to return back to degree study, it is often what they would see as kind of safe and secure jobs, such as health, nursing, teaching, education. And I think the challenge for us is to say to them that jobs in engineering, social science are just as important, and that they are just as able as anybody else to return back to those jobs.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know if there's an indication from anybody online if they'd want to come in, convener. I mean, obviously, we're particularly interested in child poverty, and being a student can be quite a difficult period. So when we're talking about formal education, that can be quite a difficult period for parents. I don't know if there's an indication from anyone online.
Jackie, I believe, would like to come in. Thanks.
Good morning, and thanks for the opportunity to represent College of Scotland today. I think the key thing about lifelong learning is giving people opportunities at different points in their lives. So, for example, and I think colleges are really good for that. So I'll give you a very quick example about in West Lothian. So we've got communities in West Lothian where there's quite entrenched unemployment and quite a long history of families who have struggled to get good employment and stay in employment. And it's for a lot of people who are in the community, it's really important to reach into the communities and to give them opportunities to have short courses that then ease them into a course like the ones that Kenny was talking about, the access to nursing or whatever it happens to be. So one wee example we've got at the moment is we're running courses in Blackburn Partnership Centre, which is where the GP and the other community facilities are based, with a group of women who have not been in education, who've got children. There's a creche on site which makes sure that they can be happy that their children are looked after. And every single one of those women who've taken part in that taster course for childhood practice has actually taken up a full-time college course come August. But they would never have contemplated coming into the college before they took part in that course in the community. So it's challenging for colleges in these financial times to reach into communities and do that. And part-time courses, perversely, are actually more expensive to run. But it's really important that we do it, and I think I really welcome the Withers Report review recommendation that there should be more funding for part-time students, but also that the system should have more funding for providers of part-time courses, because it really makes a difference. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Jackie. I believe Sharon wants to come in on that. Katie, thanks.
Yes, please. Good morning. Sharon McIntyre, Head of Careers Information, Advice and Guidance at Skills Development Scotland. Pleased to be here today, a panel representing Skills Development Scotland. I just want to come in on the back of the other speakers, but take a bit of a different approach to the importance of lifelong learning to our economy and skills. So at SDS, we very much see lifelong learning as being imperative to tackling skills shortage in the economy, and we know they are across a number of areas. In terms of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, we are very much focused on building, working with partners who have already spoken around achieving a stronger and seamless lifelong learning ambition, so that makes it easier for our people in communities who are looking at upskilling, looking at how they can retrain and create a much more, secure future for them and their families is absolutely critical. Lifelong learning is about inclusive communities as well as it is about personal fulfilment and critical to the economy from our position. In terms of our role, we work with adults, we're an all-age national career service which sits in SDS as a national skills agency. So we work with adults across Scotland every day, helping them navigate the options around their lifelong learning, work very closely with colleges and to access the courses that Jackie's talked about. But also in terms of the transition to net zero, it's absolutely imperative that that is seen as an opportunity and an economic lever. So we have opportunities in our Green Jobs Workforce Academy, which is housed within My World of Work. So we talked, first speaker talked about the visibility of jobs and people being able to see, you know, what's out there and where is absolutely critical. And we want to ensure that My World of Work is being used to the optimum in that way. We have an opportunities finder there that tells anybody where opportunities are, and in particular green skills opportunities. It also helps people understand what skills they need to be able to take up these jobs and where the availability of courses and funding is. So for us in Skills Development Scotland, lifelong learning is an absolute critical facet of our learning and education system. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Sharon. I believe Katie wants to come back in.
Yes, and I mean, are there Scottish Government policies which you think make it easier to provide education and training to low-income parents? And indeed, are there policies which you think are a barrier and are making it more difficult that need to be addressed? I don't know if there's anybody online that would like to come in first.
Jackie, thank you.
Thank you. I mean, there have been some policies that have definitely helped. So, for example, the funding that colleges received this year and last, and the Young Persons Guarantee and the National Transition Training Fund enabled colleges to do many more short, sharp courses that were focused in the community. So, for example, we've got a three-week skills boost course running right now with adults in the community linked in with NHS Lothian. And at the end of this 3 weeks, they'll get a guaranteed interview for Band 2 jobs in NHS Lothian. And those courses are made possible with that funding. But unfortunately, that funding finishes this year. So it's a challenge for colleges to be thinking about how they can use the funding that they have to meet all the different demands that they have. But certainly those policies in recent years have been helpful to colleges. And it'll be interesting to see what the government comes out with in terms of more flexibilities for colleges in these really difficult times. And I suppose for my college, the key thing is, you know, we're all living in really difficult financial times, all the public sector. For me, it's about partnership working. There are many partners in West Lothian who we're all aiming to do to help the same people. And it's about how we best work in partnership. And we've created a partnership hub in our campus. And we've now got 14 local and national partners co-located with us to help people in the community to connect into courses, whether they're short courses or later on full-time courses. So there have been some policies that have helped.
Thanks, Jackie. Do you want to come back in?
Yes, I don't know if there's anyone else online that would like to come in, particularly on any problems, anything maybe that the committee needs to be aware of that need to be addressed, where there could be improvements in policy.
Can I invite Sharon if you want to come in on that?
Yes, thank you, Katie. In terms of feeding and building on what Jackie said, we agree that, you know, that there are some policies and some strategies that do support. For us, actually, the recent lifelong learning strategy is actually a fantastic approach to building that strength. And it is very much focused on partnerships and we very much see ourselves in that partnership space. I think in general there, you know, there could be a focus around targeting a lot more, just in terms of given the situation we're in with the cost of living crisis and the focus on poverty, which is, as we know, not really child poverty. It's around poverty in the widest sense in our communities and also across regions and nationally. So I think, if anything, we would see a benefit in policies, and I mean in a wide sense, being more targeted around what our priorities are, especially in that lifelong learning space where we know those people and households are most at risk, how they can be supported by a policy in essence, but actually the real work is in terms of the delivery and the practice, and even if there was an opportunity to be more targeted in practice. I'll give you an example of that in terms of how we work in schools. So we work in schools through a needs matrix. And what we do is we have a targeted approach to those young people who are from households that may be struggling. So we use SIMD data, equalities data. It's driven by an evidence base, an intelligence base. And then that's validated with the school. So we work very closely with the school around focusing on young people that should be our priority for a career service that year. And that's done every year and updated during the year as well, because circumstances change in households. So having and benefiting from a very partnership-orientated, targeted programme in school, which means we're seeing the young people who, when we're talking about parental employment, it's their parents and carers that are impacted. We look at the post-school space we're in, and it's more a universal and demand-led. And again, that's absolutely of great value. But there is also room, I think, to learn from some of the targeting and needs-driven programmes, and I know there's quite a few out there run by the third sector. So in terms of SDS, we're very closely working in partnership with the third sector on those targeted programmes that we can see they're delivering, especially around where young people aren't attending school at the moment. So what's going on with those young people and their families, and how can we support them as a partnership? So it was more a general point, Katie, around targeting, I think, is something we would observe as being a priority and an advantage at this time, given the climate we're in.
Okay. Come in on this.
First off, with the University of Scotland hat on, I'll refer to page 5 of our submission, which references that in terms of higher education, student support is primarily focused on full-time. And I think that's picked up in the SPICE briefing as well, which didn't specifically reference part-time students. Playing more to my strengths with an open university perspective, 68% of our students receive the part-time fee grant. So if you as an individual are earning less than £25,000 a year, you, for most of the courses, you'll be eligible for the part-time fee grant, which is administered through SAS. So that grant came in circa 2013, and we've seen that it's been a huge boost in supporting people to come back into education. 20% of our students don't have standard university entry qualifications, but what we're finding now is an increase in students. And only yesterday, as I was leaving the office, one of our senior advisors contacted me. They'd done a quick triage, and yes, in the last few days, we've had 3 calls from students saying, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to continue. Some are looking at either pausing their study with us, which we can do, or some are contemplating dropping out because of the cost of living crisis and the fact that the part-time fee grant threshold has never increased since it was first introduced. Now, with inflationary costs and wages going up, they're now going over that threshold and they're no longer be eligible for the fee grant. So they're having to seriously consider whether or not they can afford to continue with their studies. So that policy is extremely positive, but it needs reviews in the current circumstances if that opportunity is still going to be available to people. Another one I would quickly mention is the Upskilling Fund. That was a very positive fund, but I think I might be right. I can double check and confirm, convener. I think that might too be coming to an end, but I'll make a note and confirm that afterwards. Again, that allowed people to access short courses in terms of getting them back into a workplace for retraining or upskilling.
Thank you. Kenny?
Thank you, Katie. We certainly benefit from the policies in respect of fair access and the focus on fair access from the Scottish Government. We receive our funding from that pot of money from the Scottish Funding Council, so that has certainly helped us. And we've received that money direct from the Scottish Funding Council since 2011, and that's provided us with a lot of certainty. If we look at the history of our organisation in terms of how we've worked when we've been more reliant on project funding, that's been a little bit more difficult for us. So that policy has certainly helped us as an organisation in terms of strengthening the work that we do through our colleges and giving them the assurance that that work will continue into the future. There are elements in respect of the fact that we live in a country where we have free tuition fees for our students to have that certainty when they are progressing to university, which we should never underestimate in terms of their thinking, and that comes up time and time again when we talk to our students about why they have returned back to education. We had an interesting one when we looked at our evidence of our students who are parents and the ages of their children, and we've got that evidence for over 30 years. And there was, I always quite like it when my stats are quite boringly reassuring in terms of what I do every year. But one element that we did notice around about 2011, 2012, was that we began to see evidence of the fact that there had been kind of universal childcare for three-year-olds, because the normal age that the normal age of a child for students returning back at before that time was five, where we saw that beginning to reduce to three, which was an interesting one for us, because it was not necessarily something that we had expected at that time, but made sense later on. If I can just quickly say that in terms of this work that we do, it does require an infrastructure there. So no matter how well our programmes run, we need a really strong college infrastructure. And within that, we need an infrastructure of childcare so that our students have got really good childcare facilities. And we need an infrastructure of transport so that they can get to their college as well. So, you know, I appreciate that one of the aspects that this committee in particular is grappling is just where there is implications across a broad range of policy fields, which has an impact on poverty. And we would hope that education would be seen as part of that infrastructure, but we don't always have all the answers, because that requires a little bit more of a holistic approach.
Okay. Project 12 in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation includes developing a stronger, simplified lifelong learning system, including support targeted at those who need it most. To what extent do you expect low-income parents will be the main focus? I don't know if Kenny would want to come in on that.
I mean, that's probably for other people to say whether or not they would be the main focus. I very much hope that they will be. I think we really benefit in Scotland from having the Scottish Credit Qualifications Framework. I think that's come up in the last two reports that they have. And that allows us as an education system to be able to look at those that we feel that we have to target and where those resources should go into. For myself, there are kind of key elements in terms of people returning back to education, which looks at them being targeted at those with looking to have development within SCQF levels 4, 5 and 6. So some of the aspects that Jackie spoke about, some of the pre-access programmes that our college partners run, are really helpful for us in terms of ensuring that students will be successful when they return to that level. And for me, it's less about simplification, actually having a lot of diverse routes that meets the needs of a diverse range of adults, because not all adult students are the same, is really important. But if there can be that focus on that, on those students, then I think that we'll start to see the benefits of that in respect of attacking poverty.
Keith, were you wanting to come in on this one?
No, I don't think I would add
to what's been said. I don't know if any of the online witnesses are indicating that they have anything to add. I mean, my final question is how we can ensure that a diverse range of education is available. I know there's been a number of references, both to green jobs, but also to some of the more caring professions that perhaps low-income parents look to. But how do we ensure that there truly is a diverse range of opportunities available to low-income parents, and also maybe the opportunities that the economy needs, but also maybe lead to well-paid employment? I don't know if any of the witnesses in the room would like to come in. Maybe Keith?
I think increasingly we're going to have to see greater collaboration and partnership. I think each of us could probably give some really good examples, and some have been done already, between the sectors, between different institutions. I attracted that idea of the partnership hub at West Lothian College. That sounds quite positive and quite interesting. As a sector, we do look to provide opportunities, and each of the institutions will have good relationships with colleges in their own locality. With Open University, is obviously a national university, so we have students in every parliamentary constituency and region. But we work with all of the colleges outside of the UHI network. So we've got articulation agreements, we've got strong partnerships, and increasingly we'll have to look with the third sector. We've been having discussions with SWOP about how we can look closer. But I think if we're going to meet some of those challenges, then as funding reduces, then there is an imperative and greater collaboration.
Mm-hmm. Kenny?
I believe Jackie and then Sharon, but can I just remind everyone to be more succinct and concise with your responses. We've got until round about 10:10 before our next panel arrive. Thank you. I bring in Jackie. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I mean, colleges, a very significant proportion of students at colleges are from low-income families, and I absolutely would argue that we have to continue to make sure we support more low-income families. And in terms of lifelong learning, you know, young people inspire the parents can inspire the young people. Colleges across Scotland just now are celebrating success of those students that Kenny talked about at levels 4, 5 and 6 in the SDQF. And the stories that you hear, you see adults who've been through learning, and you see their children with them, and you can see that there's a positive story there to tell. But you also see parents coming with their children, and then the parents starting to think, I wonder if this is for me. And many of those parents have never been inside a college before. So I think that's really critical that we continue to focus on those families and go with that. And just one final thing about transport. There's bus routes being cut across West Lothian, and it's absolutely cutting off the opportunity for low income or anybody actually in these outlying communities to come into college, even though it's just a few miles away. So these buses not being available at all, or else not being available at the right time, are absolutely denying people in our communities the opportunity for lifelong learning.
Okay, thanks, Jackie. Can I now bring in Sharon? Thank you.
Yes, thank you. It's just to bring in the in terms of the diverse range of options. I think it's really critical. We talk about work-based learning options as well, so the role of employers in this space, and the critical focus on intelligence as well in terms of local market information. I think the evidence and the role of employers are absolutely critical in an integrated approach and community. So the employability hubs, that's also something we support in Jackie's area and nationally, and are developing much more integrated hubs in our cities and communities. But I have to make the point, I think it's imperative employers are included in that, and that work-based learning opportunities are part of that diverse portfolio of accessible options for our parents and low incomes. Thank you.
Thanks, Sharon. I'm now going to bring in James.
Can I ask Sharon first, how can we develop apprenticeships and other work-based learning for low-income parents?
Am I okay to come in? Yes. Hi, James. So as you know, yes, we have apprenticeships that start at school-based and up to graduate level. So they are open to all, so including low-income parents. We don't actually have an eligibility around low-income parents in particular. So they are universal, but we do very much focus, as I talked about earlier, even at a school level, on encouraging young people to look at apprenticeships as an option and support parents and carers in understanding what apprenticeships are and how they could be of value to them, and not only to them, but also influencing their young people. So James, we've got a parent carer strategy in place at Skills Development Scotland, which is all about how we look at different ways of engaging parents, in particular low-income parents, to support a range of opportunities. And that's underpinned by our adult all-age careers advice as well. So we do support parents, low-income parents in the round, and apprenticeships is one of the pathways that is open to them.
Is there any measurement of participation of low-income parents or parents in general into apprenticeships?
We do obviously measure and collect information on take-up and placements. That's something I would need to follow up with you on, James, if that's okay. I don't have to hand.
Yeah, that'd be helpful if you could get back to the committee on that one. I wonder, does anybody else want to come in and either of those 2 points? No, if not, I'm happy to move on.
Yeah, thanks, James.
Right, okay. This one again probably comes back to you, I'm sorry, but it's about the individual training account being paused. When will it be reinstated, and what impact is its absence having?
Yeah. So we're launching the ITAs in July, actually, James. So that's just been approved with Scottish Government. There has been a delay in launching just really due to budget discussions, the challenges around that. Working with Scottish Government, we have now agreed an approach and will be launching access to a total of 6,000 ITAs from next month. That's for the 23-24. For those learners that apply, they will go forward into this new launch and will be able to take up an ITA through that process. And in terms of the pause, we've still not stood still in terms of supporting those learners through a range of information we provide through My World of Work and our CIEG helpline, as well as an all-age service around funding opportunities, learning opportunities. And in My World of Work, our website, there is an extensive list of opportunities there for learners. So we feel that where a learner had expressed an interest, we still have been able to support them and deliver a service. And also, even in that time, we've looked at, you know, the criteria underneath the ITA. So we're working very closely with the Scottish Government and exploring some of the kind of cap around the salary in there, which we feel needs explored again. So it's given us a chance to look at how we can improve the ITA as well. But that's been launched very soon, James.
So could you reassure me to some extent, but that nobody has been impacted negatively or severely negatively because of the pause in this ITA?
Yes, I can, James. I am confident enough that we have a range of other services and support in the learning space, and we have that one-to-one guidance through our adult career service.
Right, I have to ask you this then.
Okay.
Why the ITA? If you've already got things in place and you say that they are being adequately supported and aren't losing out, if it's not there, then What's the point?
Good question. So it's actually about a kind of wider visioning opportunity that we see, and it's under MSET as well. So that focus on empowering people with their own skills, being able to use a fund in a way that they can create a range of options from a kind of funding base, so that the empowerment of people to be able to drive forward a focus in their own skills, and that can be from, as you know, a variety of places that they look at developing their skills. And that comes back to discussions we've been having around the future kind of potential of a skills wallet, you know, that would be a kind of empowered approach to people in communities, especially low-income parents in particular, who could use a kind of skills wallet entitlement to make sure they're taking up learning that actually suits their interests and their career goals. So actually, we think the IT is an important tool to be able to help people navigate their own careers. As you know, in the National Career Service, we're very much built around career management skills focus, where we're supporting people to drive their own careers, to support their own pathways to reaching that dream job. And those career management skills are necessary to the way that they actually navigate that pathway. So an ITA, the ITAs for us are that kind of empowered approach to the traditional service delivery that we support around that. So I hope that helps.
Just it gives them flexibility around the learning process. That's great. That's really helpful.
Yes, sorry.
Right, no more. Okay, I have one more question. Sian, I won't ask you it. You've done enough. I was going to start off with Kenny, and if any of the others would like to respond, that'd be great. Should there be specific workplace training and upskilling funds targeted at low-income parents?
I mean, our programme is very much in and around academic development, James, and that's we're looking to provide them with that provision because they feel that that is their need and requirement. I suppose my answer would relate to always try and bring it back to what the actual needs are of the adults who you're wanting to work with. And the one thing that we always find when we're talking to our students is that they're a really diverse bunch. And what I would never want to have is a position where there was a policy that was shoehorning people into one option. We realise in swap isn't always the best thing for all adults who are looking to return back to education. I think it's got benefits for a number of them. What I suppose I would prefer to see is a kind of more diverse approach, where if somebody is looking to regain and get back into the workplace, that they have an opportunity to attend a local college that's going to be able to provide them with that options. If they are looking for an education response that's going to take a longer period of time, that's going to engage colleges and universities, that they have the opportunity for that as well. For me, it's the options of choice and having those choices there and that investment that provides those choices. I'm sure Jackie will maybe be able to go into that in a little bit more detail than I've been able to answer for you, James.
Well, there you go, Jackie. He's just passed the ball to you. So let's see your run with it.
Sorry, can I just remind everybody to try and be more succinct and concise with our responses here, because we are running way behind time and there's a lot of other members want to come in with some questions as well. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll try and do that. Absolutely think that we have to have the flexibility to support work-based learning for those in low-income families, both who are in work and who are out of work. So, you know, the IT is a really vital tool, but it runs out during the year, and many people who are in low-paid jobs, in, for example, the care sector, want to upskill in order to do the job that they're doing, but also to progress in their job. And very often they rely on things like ITA. So I think colleges having the flexibility and the ability to tap into other resources to provide more of that is absolutely necessary.
Okay, thank you. Okay, convener, thanks very much. Unless Keith is desperate again.
Brief, I promise, Convener. The two different perspectives on that. We do a regular business barometer. Our next one's out at the end of the month. And last year we found a bit of a disparity between what employees said they wanted in terms of upskilling and reskilling and what employers thought. So if you were looking at targeted funding for low-income parents, you'd think quite carefully about what the needs are. I think that money would be better focused on things like the part-time fee grant and actually some sort of maintenance grant or access to maintenance loan for part-time students. I think whether you're with the Open University or whether you're at college, if you're a part-time student, you don't have the same ability to access funding as you do if you're a full-time. And that funding is vital to getting people to be retrained.
OK, thanks.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Convener.
OK, I'm going to bring in Miles now.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us here and online today. I'm going to try to merge my three questions. It was in relation to course structures and delivery models, and to what extent course timetabling and structures can be made more flexible in order to accommodate a more diverse range of students. Now, I know the majority of students on SWOP are parents, and so flexibility around childcare we've heard already. But I just wondered, in terms of the 2022 National Strategy for Economic Transformation, it did highlight some of the need for flexible provision. So just wondered what the panel's view was that, and any examples of where we've seen changes. So I mentioned SWOP, so I'll maybe bring you in first, Kenny.
Thanks, Miles, on that. I'll try and be succinct. Something's very difficult, so apologies, convener. We're pretty passionate about the work that we do. There's some very simple and straightforward measures that most of our college partners will do, which is provide flexibility for people to drop off their kids and then get into classes and not have that kind of structured, we expect you to be there at 9 o'clock. Most of our college partners are incredibly good at sorting out their timetable as such, so that students can not only look after their children but also work. And I think one element that is there, particularly those that the committee is trying to focus on, is that they are juggling childcare and work as well, and our colleges will be flexible in terms of that. We are looking, this is probably very much post the pandemic and reflecting on the pandemic, in terms of trying to be as flexible as we possibly can with learners around blending face-to-face and online, looking at a two-year provision of an access programme. My colleague Leslie with Small Peace has got a really innovative piece of work that they're doing with the NHS up in Grampian and Moray College, where health practitioners who are working with the health board will have the opportunity to study over 2 years, so they're not going to lose their hours. So those elements are just really helpful bread and butter aspects that make lives easier for students.
That's helpful. I know the majority of courses, I think, Keith, for Open University is also able to be provided online. So is that also providing flexibility? And with the pandemic, that change in learning as well is maybe the future as well.
Yeah, time and time again, we hear from our students about how our provision allows them to be fit around their work and their caring responsibilities so they can study. We've got a very handy study calculator where we just an Excel spreadsheet where you work out all your different commitments in a week, in a day, and then think about, I mean, it's very basic, but actually in a stark way helps. We got taken through as a staff team the other day, helps students think about the commitment that is required. But as an institution, our model is very flexible and suits the needs. Obviously, I would draw attention to page 2 of the University of Scotland Committee, University of Scotland submission, and looking at innovative work such as the University of West of Scotland gives students their timetable, their prospective timetable, within 24 hours of enrolment, so they can make arrangements, so they know in advance, there's no last-minute planning, and then both at Glasgow Caledonian and Edinburgh University, other projects are ongoing to ensure flexibility and to meet students' needs.
Thank you. One of the things we have heard as a committee as well is around urban and rural Scotland, different issues for people, especially around travel and island communities as well. Now, West Lothian, part of my region, isn't necessarily that rural, but I'm wondering, Jackie, if you've already raised the issue of transport being one of the major barriers, so wondering if there's anything you want to add around that as well.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, because, you know, good bus routes is really important, and the bus routes are not great, and we're having lots of representations. But I know that local politicians, the local council and others, and including the college and our student association, have lobbied the bus company, and, you know, and there's promises they'll address that. I just wanted to add something to the question you asked about flexibilities in learning. So for many parents who've not been in education and who return, so I'm thinking about those women I talked about earlier, they've usually had bad experiences of education. They're usually very isolated in their communities, and coming together in person is absolutely critical for building up their confidence and the value and the motivation for learning. So we absolutely do a lot of online learning for students who want that flexibility, especially for those that are in work. But for those that are in very low incomes and who are isolated in communities, it's really important to give them the opportunity to come together. And, you know, during the summer, for example, 5 weeks over the summer break in our college, we've got 60 ESOL students coming in, so that they can connect with each other as a community. There's a creche on campus, and they'll be able to take part in their learning so that they can take part in courses. So the online is important, but for this group of people, it's really important to think about the in-person too.
Mm-hmm. That's good to hear. I don't know if Sharon wants to come in. If not, happy to hand back, Kamina.
Sharon, would you like to come in on that? You're on mute.
No further comment from myself.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Okay, I'm now going to invite Marie to come forward with some questions. Thanks.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for your time this morning. How does the financial support available to students in Scotland compare with the rest of the UK? Is there any type of student support in other parts of the UK that we should replicate in Scotland? Let's pop that out to anyone who can answer it.
Wales, we've had the Diamond funding, which has dramatically increased the amount of part-time students, primarily signing up with the Open University, and that's bespoke to the system in Wales, which is by far the largest partner. It's not just a shameless plug for the institution. It reflects the situation in Wales. But that gave some grants that hadn't been there before. And you saw quite a significant increase in part uptake. What they didn't have prior was anything equivalent to the part-time fee grant that we had. But it was less about tuition fees, more about a support grant. So that's certainly one model we've flagged up to civil servants in the past.
Thank you for that. Anyone else want to come in? Jackie?
I don't know the answer to the question, but I know that Colleges Scotland have done some work recently, actually, comparing against the other nations in the UK, so I'm pretty confident we could get you an answer to that one. And I think for me, there's also the issue of universal credit. Universal credit is a major barrier to families both in work and out of work in terms of engaging in learning because of all the conditions and all the impacts it has on their benefits. So that's a really big issue across the UK. But I'm sure College of Scotland will get that information to you.
Thanks, Jackie. That would be really helpful. Swap Submission says...
Sharon,
just to come in very briefly on in terms of reducing the financial costs. Another side of the coin. And coming from a student perspective, but school-based, we've greatly value the free bus travel. You know, so that's really made a difference to finances and families and that pressure and support. Also, we are influencing UCAS. We're working with UCAS around the fees to make UCAS applications as well. So it's just to let you know, from a CIG point of view, we're focused on reducing financial barriers as well as promoting methods of support. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, no, Swap's mission obviously says that unexpected crises are a reason for students not being successful. That's your submission. How can you improve crisis support for parents, students? For example, would better links to money advice or the Scottish Welfare Fund be helpful?
Marie, I think one of the elements is when we have students in college, student support systems are really good in terms of ensuring that they've got that finance side. I feel kind of confident enough, provided students have the confidence to get in touch with us to kind of talk about these issues. A lot of them stem actually from challenges and difficulties that there are in respect of universal credit, as Jackie had mentioned earlier on. And one particular challenge that we often have is that, you know, colleges are great with their discretionary funds, but sometimes those discretionary funds can cause difficulties with people who are on universal credit. And when that challenge is, oh my goodness, that balance of things going wrong, that's where those issues can cause difficulties. I think that's less of an advice and information problem and one where if we could really get stuck into the benefit system, we could actually start to do some good with that.
And how should that be reformed and, like, you know, to remove the barriers and the cliff edges? Any kind of examples?
In terms of finance, I mean universal credit is a benefit we're presuming that we're trying to get people back to work. They shouldn't be out of work and they should get back into work. I would hope that when you know, the kind of Scottish Government looks at their benefits, and certainly the evidence in terms of that has been good so far, that presumption of going into education and education being a good thing as part of the principles may be something that provides usefulness. And from a student's perspective, just knowing the work that they are doing is valued is really good for them when they come across all the different systems that they're engaged and involved with as they try and navigate their time through study. They don't want additional stresses, they just want to be able to focus on their study. So once we have them in the system and there is investment in student support, that should be sufficient for them to get that proper advice that they require. Convener, I promise I'll be succinct, but there are also issues over in terms of how we get people into the system, in terms of the guidance that they're receiving in respect of money and some of the benefits that they actually have from becoming a student and getting involved in the system. And that may be where there's opportunities, Mary, to work more in partnership with some of those agencies that you were speaking about earlier.
Thank you. Jackie, you've already touched on universal credit. Anything else you'd like to expand on?
Absolutely. I mean, the cost of living has been a huge crisis for students and for families, and colleges across Scotland have done amazing things, actually, to try and mitigate it. You know, most of us provide a free hot breakfast and a free hot lunch for our students to make sure that they've got at least something to keep them going during the day. But the partnerships are the critical thing here. There are lots of third sector and public sector partners, and that's why we've created this hub. They come on campus, they work with our student funding teams, they point people to funding that they can access via different means. They also, we get them, you know, help parents, you know, find how they can get free uniforms for their children, how they can even get help at Christmas for presents. So partnership is fundamental in these difficult times, but structurally, I totally agree with Kenny. We have to address the universal credit system because that's a huge barrier. But I think colleges are doing really well with the funding that they're getting and also the funding they're pulling in from partners to support students who are in dire need at the moment.
Thank you. Anyone else want to come in before I hand back to the convener? No, back to yourself.
Okay, thanks very much, Marie. I'm now going to invite Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I'm particularly interested in information and advice that's provided to people who are looking to, you know, get back into education and training, particularly obviously parents with a low income. I'll maybe start in terms of the kind of university space. Obviously, the Open University has a dedicated helpline that our advisors, people can speak to. Do you feel that works quite effectively in terms of, you know, those people who are looking for that information and advice, and what more can be done in that space?
Yes, our my colleagues work extremely hard, and that was particularly challenging during the pandemic, trying to make sure that students were supported at a difficult time. I think when students are aware of those services, they're well supported. The challenge, like any advice line, is getting information out there so people are aware of it. We do that through our partnerships with the colleges, with advertising. There's always more that can be done to improve. Nobody should rest on their laurels, but I think once they reach that touch point, then the service is good. But it's about making sure people are aware they can phone up in the first instance and just simply inquire or come through our website. They get taken through a series of steps.
I wonder for other members of the panel, in terms of, I suppose, your own kind of sphere of influence, do you feel that obviously, the challenge is getting the information out there. So what methods have you employed in terms of being able to tell people who have so much going on in their life in terms of the demands on their time that they can have access to these opportunities?
If I could come in first, then. I mean, one of the most hardest things that an adult has to do when they're returning back to education is pick up the phone and speak to somebody to begin with. We within SWOP are very much reliant on our college colleagues. We ask students how they find out about SWOP, and for us it's that kind of community engagement that colleges will have that will allow them to find out about SWOP. And information and advice and guidance has also got to be trusted, so there has to be an element that is regarded as an organisation that I can go to, that they're open, that they're going to spend time and they're going to talk to me on that. So that investment on that first point of contact is really essential for us in order then to bring people in. One of the things that we will often do is that after colleges, the next way in which people find out about SWOP is actually through their family and friends and those that have been through the programme, again, because of that trusted element of it. So we actually will often ask our students to kind of do our marketing for us, but that's useful because if that's somebody from my background that's been able to return, then that's far more likely to have an impact than a leaflet or a newspaper article or anything else. And social media has actually probably been more beneficial for us in terms of getting those sort of messages out than kind of maybe more the standard ways.
I don't know. I don't know if Sharon can hear.
I don't know if Sharon, can you hear us? Okay.
Yes. Sorry. Until now, I can hear you now. Yes. Yes. So just to echo what other members have been saying, our focus. Of course, we've got the My World of Work in terms of that online presence and chat function there, so we can support you directly online. We've got our CIG helpline as well, which has qualified advisors at the end of the phone. So if that is a preferred way of engaging with us, we are there, helpline at the ready. We also have, of course, colleagues will know, our centres and community venues and integrated employability hubs across Scotland to engage and share information. Social media is critical for us, and we've been looking at how we move content onto platforms like TikTok. We've just trialled an Instagram Q&A. There was a lot of young adults participating in that. We've also got new marketing material where it's got a quick reference code, so if you just scan it with your mobile, then you'll be able to access advice through through that means directly. So we are constantly looking at ways that we can improve the way we deliver information, advice, and guidance. Thank you.
Okay, I believe Jackie would like to come in. Thanks.
I won't repeat what other people have said, but I think a really important thing is for people and communities, any organisations that they engage with are able to tell them about what's available to them. So the partnership hub that I'm talking about are partnerships with Community Learning and Development, with DWP, with Skills Development Scotland. Having those partners working closely together means they will pass on that information. And I'm delighted to say that Skills Development Scotland will be joining our partnership hub very soon. And the Open University, you're very welcome to come along and talk to us about you two being located on our campus.
There we are. This committee providing opportunities for that synergy. We're always glad to do it. Convener, I wonder just on that point, because that was perhaps my next question, was that partnership working. And you mentioned, Jackie, there, DWP, and I suppose the Job Centre Plus space. I mean, do you feel that advisors in that setting are doing enough and are trained well to share, I suppose, these opportunities and be, I suppose, supportive in saying, actually, we can take you through and get you the right information and advice that you need?
Yeah, I think they'll be trained in their own skill set. The key thing is, if the more they know about the local college, the more they know about Skills Development Scotland, then the better advice they're going to give people. So that's what, I mean, I think colleges across Scotland are really good at those relationships, and it's not about you go over here for that particular advice and you come over here for a different piece of advice. If you've got them all in the one space, it can really make a huge difference about connecting people to education, because you can sort out the funding, the childcare, everything else, mental health problems, whatever it happens to be, you can sort it all out with the partners coming into the same space. So I think they have got the skills. It's just about connecting them with everybody else.
Thanks. I imagine, convener, that provision might look different in different parts of the country, so it might be helpful for us to reflect on what good looks like in that space. I wonder if I can just finally, convener...
Before you do, can I just... I believe Sharon would like to come in.
Of course.
Thanks.
Great, thank you. Yeah, just to first of all thank Jackie. Delighted to be working with you in Open University. But the point around partnership is absolutely critical. So we've got strategic agreements with Social Security Scotland and DWP. So we share continued professional development learning together. So that's upskilling each other when we're in front of a customer. We have to make sure that we are able to offer a range of supports that go much more out with our own services. So it's just to let you know there's a framework underneath that as well to review. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. Thanks, convener. Very interesting, and I think this committee has been particularly interested in childcare and using particularly the 2-year-old option that's been rolled out to specific families as a means to getting people back into education and training. And I wonder to what extent have you engaged in that space, because we know that there have been challenges in terms of identifying families and getting them the right kind of holistic support, but we know that there are family centres, for example, across the country, and that model has worked on the partnership sort of hub approach that we were just discussing there. So have you had much engagement in terms of the kind of 11-40 hours and the rollout to 2-year-olds and essentially getting to those parents, I suppose. Don't know who wants to. I mean, I don't know if Sharon has any views, obviously, from maybe the more coordinating role from SDS.
Yes, so where I would say that we were most influential is through community planning partnerships. And we know there has been a particular focus on childcare schemes, vouchers, the promotion of places, in particular subgroups and CPPs that we are on. So our role is instrumental in supporting the solutions to where at a customer level childcare is an issue, and the flexibility of childcare is incredibly important. For us, we are still seeing that childcare sufficiency as an issue nationally, and I do think that I know that's something that you've been looking deeply into. And where we can work again in partnership, we do to support. Especially working with the PVI sector, so not just local authorities, but private and voluntary sector providers of childcare. I think that's really important. And I think those partnerships are critical. I also think there's a perception of hidden costs around the wraparound of childcare as well that I think would help as well in terms of take up and understanding what the situation households are actually in. So it's not just a simple kind of matching in of childcare that suits the needs of the employment aspect. It's wider than that. And we're getting a lot of information back from the local discussions we're having, the regional discussions around the childcare sufficiency element. And that's something we are focused on in partnership. Thank you.
If Jackie would like to come in.
Absolutely. Colleges obviously are very critical in developing the childcare workforce to meet the increased provision that's available, and that happens across the country. Our partnership with the Council's early learning and childcare team is really critical, both in raising visibility of communities across the area about what childcare provision they're entitled to and is available, but also in ensuring that we can then support the providers in terms of people who will end up working for them. So those women I talked about earlier in Blackburn, I've got no doubt that a good number of those will end up being early years practitioners because there's so many jobs actually available in that area.
Really quickly, if that's okay. And this is a perspective that we have from our students who are parents, is they'll actually see it from what is their support mechanism that they're going to require for childcare, which is broader than just childcare providers. So it's ensuring that they've got their support mechanism within their family and their friends for returning in, particularly for a number of our single parents. It's actually support that they'll have from their broader family that's there as well. So we quite rightly spend a lot of time talking about, you know, childcare providers, but it's actually broader than that for students who are looking to return back to education.
Okay, thanks very much. I've just got a last question here before we finish up, and it's I'm going to put it to Keith Kenny, and if Jackie would maybe like to come in on this as well, would be what will the impacts be of the tightening of college and university budgets on provision for adult returners and student parents, and particularly low-income parents as well? And if I could ask Keith that question first of all.
I think if the budget continued to be reduced, then it's probably inevitable there'll be a reduction in opportunity. We're seeing across the sector job cuts, there'll be fewer resources available within colleges and or universities, potentially fewer opportunities, courses not perhaps being run that would otherwise have happened. And I think obviously it's wider, there's part of the wider bit is that student financial support. If the part-time fee grant threshold doesn't get increased, then there'll be fewer opportunities for people to access education via that route that otherwise had been a vital lifeline for them.
Okay, thanks, Keith. Kenny?
Yeah, we're a college-based programme, so you know we're always really concerned about the capacity in terms of our colleges for running our programmes. Swap access programmes require a lot of engagement and involvement from our college partners because we ask them to deliver more credits as part of that programme because we're getting people ready quickly in order to progress on. They are, and I say this with love in my heart, sometimes a challenging group of students to work with. They're well-liked and well-liked to teach, but they come with a lot of additional challenges as well. Now, what we see is a real commitment to SWAP and that work across all our colleges, but people like Jackie have to balance the books, and my job is to kind of navigate that with some of the senior teams that are looking at that. We have, if I can give just one quick example, one of our most popular programmes is access to nursing, and our nursing numbers are actually really consistent and good, and a lot of the drop-in nursing for universities has actually been more from schools than it has been from adults. But I'm beginning to worry about our capacity for delivering the amount of programmes that we'll need to deliver in our colleges in the future if things continue to go the way they're going.
Okay, thank you. And can I invite Jackie to come in? Thanks. You're on mute, Jackie.
Oh, sorry. We deliver access to nursing, and it's been great speaking to those students over the year and how they're all virtually all now going on to university to become nurses, and that's fantastic. And we're totally committed to continuing to do that. In fact, we've seen double the applications for those places for next year. So undoubtedly for colleges, it's really hard with, you know, the tight financial situation that we face. And you know, colleges are very agile. We'll change and we'll try and do our best. And we absolutely will focus on those in most need. But it's really critical, I think, for government to think about other areas that colleges can get funding from. We'll help tackle poverty, we'll help achieve the economy that we want as a Scottish Government, but there are other pockets of funding that could support colleges, not just from the education budget, and I would encourage the government to look at that to see how we can support people in communities to get the careers and the jobs that make them happy and content.
Okay, thanks, Jackie. And that brings our panel evidence session to an end. And I'd like to thank the witnesses for the evidence they have given here today. And I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for the set-up of the next panel. So thank you very much indeed. Welcome back, and we're now going to hear from our second panel on employability programmes. So expanding employability provision is a key proposal in the Scottish Government's Best Start, Bright Futures. In the context of the current budget pressures, it is unclear what progress has been made so far and what the role of employability programmes is in the current tight job market. So I welcome our witnesses for this second panel. David Stewart, Regional Development Manager, FedCap Scotland, and Philip White, Director, the Institute for Public Policy Research Scotland, and they're joining us in the room. And we have Marion Davis, Director of Policy, Communications and Strategy, One Parent Family Scotland, and Sarah McCulley, Service Manager, Employment and Training, Falkirk Council, and representing the Scottish Local Authorities Economic Development Programme, Development Group, who are joining us remotely. As with the previous panel, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking, and allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can also indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans if you wish to come in on a question, and don't feel you have to answer every single question. So I'm now going to invite members to ask questions in turn, as agreed in our pre-brief. So I'm going to introduce Miles, if you want to come in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of questions to start off with regards to the Best Start Bright Futures programme, which aims to move up to 10,000 parents into sustained employment and increase wages of up to 3,000 already in employment. So I just wanted to start by asking how much of this could be achieved through the employability programmes which are being currently delivered, and whether or not there's anything specific you wanted to highlight to the committee which you think needs to change in that. So happy to bring in either David and Philip and then go online.
Sure. Okay, thanks. First of all, thank you for the invite to come and talk to you today. I'm delighted to be here from two fronts, both from personal and professional. Personally, as as somebody who's been in the sector for about 20 years, has a long-term health condition, and is a very, very, very proud father of a seven-year-old daughter who absolutely tells me what to do every single day, but also someone who has experienced the majority of my educational and professional development as a mature adult whilst being a parent. So it certainly can resonate with a lot of the information that's already been spoken about today. And professionally, from FedCap Scotland, as a not-for-profit organisation that is passionate about this area and supporting as many people as possible and working with Scottish Government, local third sector partners, local authorities to co-design local solutions to national problems. So thank you for the opportunity to talk about this. I think, Miles, and to answer your question, it depends on the structure. I think employability provision can have a huge part. I think, you know, employability is has historically been the best route out of poverty, and I think it still is, if it's the right job and it's the right the right structure of job. People are experiencing so many barriers and disadvantage and inequality just now, and I think we need the right support to provide to people. And I think Philip and I were just having a quick chat before we came in, and both organisations talk a lot about scalability. You know, we are a national provider with local presence, but we pride ourselves on being able to deliver at scale. And I think the problems, what we're talking, you know, nearly a quarter of a million children living in poverty in Scotland, you know, that this needs to be a big investment to address this. In a previous role, I worked for the Scottish Union of Supported Employment to help reduce the disability employment gap. We're talking 160,000 disabled people moving into work. These types of things can't happen on small scale in short-termism. We need to work collaboratively with the Scottish Government, with local partners to provide what people need, when they need it, and for as long as they need it.
OK. Am
I good? Yep, good to go. No, I concur. I think the ultimate point is that it has to, I think, similar to what David alluded to. So, 250,000 children living in poverty. You know, to date, Social Security has done the heavy lifting to try and reach the upcoming interim targets, particularly through the Scottish Child Payment. That is right and proper. But, you know, if you want Social Security to be the only thing that continue to do the heavy lifting to get you to the 10% final target in 2030, you're talking about a significant scale of investment, you know, the likes of which has never been seen in Scotland. So employability and childcare, you know, the other half of your inquiry, is incredibly important. That's not just getting people into work. I think it's always really important to remember, despite some of the stereotypes around poverty, 2/3 of children living in poverty are in a household where at least one person is in work. So it's not just about getting into work, but we find that quite often when people are in work, they're caught by structural inequalities, not least low pay. So employability has to play a role, but David hit the nail on the head. At the minute, the issue is scale. So you know, all the numbers in particular in our submissions and other submissions, happy to go into any of them in detail, but the kind of the core point is, at the minute, there is a massive chasm, not just in kind of the overall numbers of people that are being reached by current employability programmes and in turn those that are supported into work. That chasm alone is big enough. But when you break it down to the numbers of parents that are being reached by those programmes and then being supported into work, they are tiny in comparison to the aims and ambitions that the government has set itself. So something is going to have to give, and that is ultimately about scaling up, as David has rightly said, I think.
Thanks for that. Does anyone want to come in online?
Sarah and then Marion, I believe. Yeah,
good morning. Sarah McCulley, Falkirk Council. Thanks for having me this morning. I'm representing local authorities across Scotland who coordinate or deliver employability provision with kind of place-based approaches. And considering the question with regards to the scale, I think echoing what's been said already, we are seeing increased investment this year with regards to the delivery of parental employment support programmes across the country. And I think the figures and the reach and the scale is achievable, but similarly to what's been said already, it's partnership which is key. There needs to be a holistic approach to ensure that that reach is achieved and that services are accessible to the widest group of parents that are in our local areas. It's all about overcoming the barriers, or at least alleviating some of the barriers that parents have. And that includes financial debt, childcare, affordable transport, sector-based training, fair, sustainable employment opportunities. And to do that, we need to work in partnership and have collaborative and holistic approaches to service design and delivery. It's not just about employability and jobs, it's about supporting parents to alleviate the real and perceived anxieties they have about a variety of challenges that they are facing personally and professionally, to ensure that they get the right advice and guidance about the potential family income that can be achieved through employability. There's a perception that employability and increasing hours will make the family income greater, and actually that's sometimes a myth. Sometimes working part-time is the best option for parents and gives a much better outcome for that work-life balance as well. So there's a whole number of elements that have to come together if we want to achieve this, and many of us are already putting the foundations in place to do so.
Thank you. And Marion, did you want to come in?
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation to come along today virtually. One Parent Family Scotland's an organisation for single parents across Scotland, and we've got family services in 6 local authority areas, and in fact in 2 of the Pathfinder areas, which is part of the child poverty delivery plan. We've got a range of sort of national advice and support services through a free phone helpline, single parent forum, and a lot of web-based self-help. So we do reach a lot of single parents, and last year I think it was over 8,000 parents, children and young people that we worked with. We do that through specialist crisis interventions, single parent tailored benefits and money advice, family support, many of the things that Sarah just mentioned there, health and wellbeing, and of course employability programmes. And just to sort of pick up on what the previous sort of speaker said, is that I think the aim of supporting so many parents into sustained employment, it can only be achieved by a range of interconnected policy interventions, not just employability. Employability is only one part of what is needed. So, and I know the committee has looked at childcare, and we did put in a submission or some evidence on that as well. Childcare that not only is high quality and affordable, that has to be flexible to meet the needs of the labour market. And we feel that to achieve greater success for parents, particularly single parents, there needs to be more tailored employability provision, particularly the parents that are the priority families in the child poverty delivery plan. We do support the person-centred approach of No One Left Behind, and I think it's been a really positive development in terms of what has gone before. We feel that, yeah, that is very important, but in addition, we need to recognise that some of the groups, the families that we work with face systemic barriers and discrimination. So to challenge that, we feel there should be more group-based programmes. There are some fantastic ones, and we, as been mentioned earlier, we need to integrate family support, financial inclusion, and from our point of view, peer support as well, we feel is very important ingredient in what we do, single parents supporting each other. So I think in particular, the question asks about increasing the wages of single of parents already in employment, and that's an incredibly challenging area, and probably local authorities and other public sector employers offer the best opportunity for progression in relation to that through in-work training. We would like to see more ILM programmes, so programmes that provide paid employment while people are being trained in the job. There has been ILM programmes. I'm not sure if they're still ongoing, but No One Left Behind has had an ILM programme for the financial years 21 to 23, and we would like to see more of that, particularly within within childcare, to support parents, single parents, to sort of move into that area of employment. But I'm sure we'll touch on a lot of these issues again later.
No, that's very helpful. Thanks, Marion. I was really impressed when I visited FedCap to see some of the work coaching which you're doing in Livingston, and wanted to ask specifically, one of the conversations we had was around sustaining people once they're in work, not just matching them with a job and then job done, and just wondered if there's anything you wanted to add around other policy areas which can help achieve that, especially given the number of people who get into employment but then that job maybe fails and they go back to square one. So just wondered about any learning on that.
Great, thank you, and thanks for taking the time to come and see us, and we'd like to extend that offer to all of the committee to come and see. I think you're absolutely right, this isn't just about getting people into work. There's a real concern that you know, in my previous, before coming to Fair Start, I worked closely with Sarah at Falkirk, and the majority, you know, the longest kind of employability provision we got was probably about 20 weeks, right? And did very well with that. But with what people are experiencing now, they need that longer term. So to have 12 months pre-employment support is fantastic, you know, and then as soon as somebody gets work, to have 12 months in work support to keep them. So that's crucial. And I also think we were talking about childcare and other barriers, that giving parents access to training to progress in work is so important, but at a time when they can do it. So we've invested as an organisation over £12 million into Scotland, which demonstrates how committed we are to being here. And part of that is through our digital platform called the FedCap Hub, which all participants on programme and all partners get access to. And that allows parents in work to access training and development at a time that suits them. We can track when they use it. We know that the most popular times are between 7 o'clock at night and 2 o'clock in the morning. And it allows people to go through training at a time that suits them based on their interests and at a pace that suits them under no pressure. So that absolutely is ability. We have the in-work support. I was speaking to a previous participant, a parent the other day that didn't feel as if she was a role model to her children before getting work, has now moved into work, is now exceeding, is aware of the amazing transferable skills that she's got, and has moved in to become one of the top sales people in her company in the UK. You know, from somebody that wasn't working, and now she'd made a statement that the in-work support was so valuable. In fact, she's annoyed now because her years came to an end. But one of the statements that she had said that I'll mention to you, I said, what is the difference of this from where you were to where you are now? And she said, I now say no to my son less. Right? And it's amazing. It's so simple, but it's amazing to watch other children do things to get things and now being able to say yes. She's now purchased a 12-month pass to Edinburgh Zoo, which sounds silly, but to be able to plan and do things like that. She said, on benefits, I was day-to-day. Now, to be able to have something that I know I can do with my son, it is so important. And I think in terms of other policy areas, we're really keen to bring health, employability, poverty, disability, all these policy issues together. I think One Parent Families mentioned in their submission a lot about intersectionality, and we're passionate about this. We can no longer have commissioning for parents, poverty, disability, ethnic minority groups. We're supporting 200 Ukrainians in Scotland just now, and we're saying, what about that Ukrainian woman that comes over, right, from an ethnic minority community, or somebody in Scotland from an ethnic minority community, that is a lone parent that has a health condition and is looking for work? What programme do you advise her to go on? And how can you say to her to forget that inequality or forget that disadvantage? We'll focus on this just now. It just doesn't work like that. There needs to be more flexible eligibility criteria. We would like to change the no wrong door approach to the right door. It doesn't matter what you need or when you need it. You can get it here, and we can pull, as Sarah was saying, we can pull partners in to you rather than sending you out to other people. We'd be delighted to work with Scottish Government about designing something that would look like that.
Thanks, David. Does anyone else want to add anything on that? If not, happy to hand back. Kamina.
Sarah, I believe, would like to come in.
Yeah, just coming back to your original point there around sustainable employment and sustainable job opportunities. I think if you look at some of the policy areas that are circulating at the moment, such as NSET, and you're talking about lifelong learning, I think that correlates with what we are trying to do within the Child Poverty Funding and the PES programmes with regards to building those skills with people when they are in employment. I think also we work with a number of employers to look at the kind of business support side of things. We're looking at workforce development, and that ties in quite nicely with the work that we are then doing with individuals around upskilling them, because we are upskilling those individuals to give them real in-work progression opportunities and careers rather than just jobs, but also supporting the employers with regards to sustainable business. So we're doing all of that, and that lines in with NSET. I suppose going back to Marion's point, childcare does continue to be a real challenge. And although across the Central Belt it's less of a challenge, when you look at the issues faced in rural communities with regards to childcare, it's an ongoing challenge. And there's a lot of innovative practice out there that we could take learning from. But I think the policy area at the moment with regards to the Best Start strategic early learning and school and childcare plan is going to be really key to align with the ambitions of employability. And I suppose just finally, the other policy area that I think is key with regards to sustainable jobs is to do with the Fair Work Strategy. There's a lot of big ambitions in there, some of them relatively easy to achieve over a short period of time. However, some of them do have unintended consequences with regards to third sector and private sector organisations. And I think we just need to take a wee bit of time to realise some of the impact and support those businesses with regards to the Fair Work Strategy and bring them along with us and not just dictate what we see as being key areas for Fair Work to be successful moving forward. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Sarah. You could maybe write to us about some of the more detail around those challenges, just so that we can capture that. That'd be helpful. Happy to hand back to you, Kamina.
Yeah, I believe Marion would like to come in, and then I'm going to pass on to James. Thank you.
To add to the points that have been made, I think particularly picking up on what Philip had said earlier, that employment aims won't be achieved without policies that help tackle the crisis that so many low-income parents face, especially single parents. At One Parent Family Scotland, we've got a model where we offer a range of support for parents who are facing really serious and sort of difficult issues, results in a crisis. They're unable to buy food. We have to get them to a food bank, pay, you know, help them to pay for gas and electricity. They're often in deep debt. So we need to sort out as much of that as we can before they engage in employability work. So there's a bit before employability that we really need to fund and resource. So I suppose the point I'd like to make is that if you're in a crisis, and we've been through, you know, a lot of crises recently, the path to employment, it's, you know, the path to employment training and education, it seems more like climbing a mountain than moving along an employability pipeline. And, you know, we have seen real and substantial progress in reducing child poverty in particular. But, you know, the recent stats show that that's not really enough to meet the statutory child poverty targets. And that is linked to employability, because if you're in poverty and you're stressed, it's very difficult to even think about looking for a job. So child poverty is only tackled if parents, especially single parents, have a boost to their income through Social Security. They've got access to early years and school age childcare. It's not only affordable, but it's flexible. And obviously housing is a key issue as well. But I mean, we really hope the government will use every tool at its disposal to drive a transformation in the labour market. We want to make sure all parents have access to decent family-friendly employment, which, you know, they don't have at the moment. And especially through public procurement is an option that we could use more. And I would echo what Philip said about the Scottish Child Payment has been a real game changer. It's had a huge role in supporting hard-up families, but it is losing value in real terms day by day. And we would like to see the First Minister act as soon as possible to increase that payment to £30. And analysis, in fact, done by IPPR shows that that needs to increase to £40 if we meet the child poverty targets. Although we're talking about employability to support parents out of poverty, we still need to tackle the poverty they face so that they will move into employability programmes and then into training, education and employment.
Okay, thanks. I'm now going to bring in James, and following on from that, I'll bring in Marie. Okay.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to start off by asking, given the change in the funding allocations last year due to the emergency budget due to down in Westminster, can you expand the difference that made to the plans to expand employability support for parents? What knock-on effect did that have? I think I'll start with you, David, and then I'll ask Philip if you'll come in.
Thanks, James. Bizarrely, that was one I thought was probably not for me. But I think in terms of I clearly can't talk about budgets for local authorities, but in terms of an overall, I'm very fortunate in my job that I cover Scotland. So I speak to, I've met about 80% of LEPs and local authorities in the last year. I've engaged with 500 people across different local authorities to get an idea of what they're facing. And there's no winner at the moment to this. So the lateness of funding, the reduced funding, is a knock-on effect to everyone. So you have local authorities, some amazing people working in local authorities that are as passionate about addressing these issues as all of us in the third sector delivering it. So you've got the people in local authorities experiencing that. You then have local providers. So I've met friends that work for other organisations that are delivering fantastic work to people that are now unemployed themselves because there's no funding to keep them on. So we now get a knock-on effect at times where when that funding does come in, some of these organisations can no longer apply for them because they now don't have the resource and they can't employ people for 6 or 7 months. You know, so we're losing good people from the sector, and ultimately the people that impact most here are the people that we're trying to support, the people that we want to support. And I think there's a real space for us as a national organisation to work with the right partners in smaller organisations to create solutions and maybe help and support them into a space that they couldn't normally get to, and we benefit from the expertise that we've got. So I think there's been a lot of challenges, but maybe some of the other members would be
Yeah. Happy to add.
Okay, thanks for that. See, I thought you had nothing to say on it, but you did remarkably well. Philip, and then Sarah, please.
There was a few things to unpack. Undoubtedly, you know, the way the current fiscal framework works, the fact that we're still very dependent on UKG spending decisions, you know, does not help. You know, we had a bizarre situation last year in advance of the emergency budget review where the initial proposed tax cuts under Liz Truss were going to result in bizarrely additional money for the Scottish Government, the way that the fiscal framework works. And when those were reversed, you know, less than a month later, that money then disappeared. So there's a lot at play there. But fundamentally, you know, you just need to look at the medium-term financial strategy that was published a couple of weeks ago. The core point is that at the minute, spending plans over this Parliament outstrip expected funding available. So ultimately, what is politics? Politics is about choices. And I think that is why, whilst I think there was strong recognition, given the circumstances last year, that difficult decisions needed to be taken in year, one of the first times that kind of that had been done quite publicly and quite openly, and I think that is to be respected and commended, you can't escape the fact that actually employability was one of the areas that saw some of the most significant real cash cuts, whereas actually lots of other areas that saw cuts in year were, you know, deferred income, were, you know, staffing changes that weren't going to then come to fruition. Employability was a genuine cash cut and quite a significant one. So again, you know, you can understand why that budget review had to be undertaken, but it's inescapable that the government's justification at the time was these cuts will mean that, you know, taking this funding away, no existing activity will be impacted. What we're simply not doing is taking forward planned expansion. And I think that kind of belies the fact that the ultimate point is missing, that the planned expansion is the thing that is desperately required. So I think for that to happen in year, and you've seen the knock-on impacts, you know, things like the Parental Transition Fund are now at least a year delayed from when they were meant to be brought in. Numbers, you know, bits of expansion under Best Start by Futures have been delayed. That is going to have a knock-on impact across the rest of this Parliament unless work is done to try and catch up. So it's obviously good that that money has been restored now in 2023-24 and indeed increased further. But again, you go right back to the very start. On the basis of current numbers, people that are being supported, and comparing that against the ambitions that the government has set, it's not enough just to simply reverse and add a little bit on to that in-year cut. Something again has to give that goes much further if we're to meet those ambitions over this Parliament.
Can I come in on that, Philip? I mean, you're right. I mean, you're spot on in what you say, but does it not just show the sort of futility of the funding mechanism where, you know, you're waiting to the last minute? We're waiting to the last minute as a government to know exactly what we're able to pass on to make sure that these programmes are funded. I mean, the whole thing should be streamlined from Westminster all the way down to the level that we're talking about here.
Absolutely. I am not going to disagree. You know, I think there are still a huge number of issues to be worked through the fiscal framework review happening. That's a whole different committee and a whole different... We could spend hours talking about the way the fiscal framework currently works. And so I absolutely, again, appreciate why that emergency budget review had to be undertaken. But again, I think the ultimate point is we know what expected funding looks like across the rest of this Parliament. We know that that is less than the kind of spending plans the Scottish Government has made that were set kind of, you go right back to the start of this Parliament and the very first programme for government of this Parliament. We know that that is going to be incredibly tight to deliver. So again, politics is about choices. The fiscal framework does not help in managing those budget decisions. But again, if we're serious about meeting those ambitions that have been set in Best Start by Futures, that is going to require some further difficult decisions about where we spend our money.
Okay, thank you, Sarah.
Yeah, thank you. I don't want to repeat anything that's been said already, but I think we need to remember that employability support, although funded quite heavily from Scottish Government through No One Left Behind, is also funded by local authorities themselves through their core budgets and other external funding, such as European funding, UK government funding and a variety of other areas as well. I think the double challenge at the moment is that, as we know, local authorities are trying to make significant savings internally as well. Employability is not a statutory service, so there's the challenge of potentially being seen as an area that could take some significant cuts with minimal impact So we need to bear that in mind moving forward. I suppose on a more positive note, certainly the investment around parents this year has been significantly increased, and local authorities and local employability partnerships were aware that that may be the case moving forward, and have put a lot of work into building those foundations of where key development is required and what priority geographies, with what priority groups utilising local data to make sure that that increased investment is targeted in a way that will be most effective. Coming back to the point that was made a moment ago, yes, it is a significant challenge not knowing what your funding allocation is. And it's not just to the last minute. We didn't receive grant offer letters until June this year. So you're already a quarter into your delivery year before you know what you have to spend and what the parameters are around the provision that you want to deliver. And then your spend has to be not just committed, but actually out the door by the end of the year. So it means that you are running at significant pace. However, communications prior to that at least gave us the opportunity to work with wider partners around what we could start putting in place and developing so that it was in a ready-made plan as soon as we had the green light with regards to grant offer letters. So the positive thing is that we're there now and we're moving forward at pace to increase the offer to parents at local level.
OK, thank you. I'm just going to... One last question, convener.
Yep.
Yeah. Do you have any of the witnesses have any insights on the progress within with the £15 million transition fund panel?
So again, that's been delayed. Sorry, keep forgetting for the red light. As far as I understand, that has again been delayed by, well, it's at least more than a year now since Best Start by Futures. Again, ostensibly, I think some of the reasons, I think there's probably budgetary pressures. Certainly, I think government has also experienced difficulties in working with UK government to try and sort out, again, what it was planning to do with that fund and in turn the impacts on potentially reserved benefits. But I think it's supposed to take it more widely. So it's delayed. I think that's disappointing. And I think particularly given what was announced by UKG in terms of childcare reforms, it potentially shifts what you want to spend that budget on. But I suppose going back to one of the questions that Miles asked previously, I think that's where this again becomes quite important, that £15 million fund will be incredibly important. I think the original tension was that a lot of it would be dedicated towards childcare and particularly the upfront cost of childcare. But again, what it requires is, as lots of other witnesses have spoken to, is actually a much wider, much more holistic offer to parents. And I think, again, that's the trick that we're missing. You could spend that entire £15 million just addressing childcare challenges and still leave a big black hole. So I think, what we don't quite have is the recognition that there are so many issues that parents face that there's not just the childcare, but there's the transport costs in terms of getting to childcare. There's the housing costs involved. There are the costs of, you know, even just, you know, clothes for interviews, being able to kind of the things that you do during the day, everything else. So I suppose, sorry, that took it a bit more widely than you had asked, but the short version is it has been delayed by at least a year, but I think we need to see progress quite quickly on it.
Okay, thank you. Sarah, you wanted to come? Then, Mary, if that's all right, convener.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
thank you.
It was just to say that I asked this morning, and I believe that the first meeting took place with Scottish Government and local government this week. And again, just reiterating what's been said already, they were looking at the information and advice that had been received from HMRC and DWP in relation to impact on benefits when utilising that fund. That's all the information I have.
Okay, thank you for that. Annie?
Hi. We at One Parent Family Scotland met to Scottish Government officials about the Parent Transition Fund a couple of years ago, it'll be now. Obviously, the aim is to tackle the financial barriers parents face in entering the labour market. And I think, as Philip said, it was particularly focusing on upfront childcare. And obviously that was something the UK government have kind of made some kind of policy changes on, although it isn't going to help all parents with upfront costs for childcare. So that has kind of changed, I would imagine, the focus of the fund. But what we had suggested, we were never that keen on that anyway. I think as Philip said, there's a lot of areas around childcare that you know, it's very costly. But we suggested the introduction of a job start payment, so similar to the new payment that helps young people with costs associated with the transition into paid work. I think for young people, the job start payment is something like £250 or two roundabout, and for a young person with children, it's £404. So we sort of thought, yeah, that's maybe an opportunity to follow the principle of a cash first approach, whereby the parents would be able to use that cash for, you know, the areas where they have the need. Could be travel to work, it could be they would make that decision.
Okay, thank you for that. Thank you, convener.
Okay, I'm now going to pass over to Marie and then we'll bring in Jeremy. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. The Scottish Government has a commitment to all-age guarantee of support for those most disadvantaged in the labour market. Focus on the priority groups. One parent families have made a suggestion in their submission. Marion, what discussions has One Parent Family Scotland had on this issue with the Scottish Government?
We haven't as yet had any discussions on this. I know our chief exec's on the Child Poverty Board, so potentially I did highlight this to her to say this was something that might be of interest to the board, but kind of the whole sort of idea of it is to build on the principle of the Young Persons Guarantee, and that is for anyone aged between 16 and 24, and that the all age guarantee would focus on the priority groups. But she thinks a really positive thing, because although the Child Poverty Strategy has been in advance, we feel there should be more of a focus on the priority groups, the parents that head up those priority groups in the Child Poverty Strategy. So for those that are disadvantaged in the labour market and have been out of work for a while, parents and carers, we really would like to see something really practical happening with that, and I think as far as I'm aware, would involve Skills Development Scotland. What I would say is that I think access to support, particularly kind of into training and education, is very challenging for single parents. And we've been involved in some interesting research with the University of West Scotland and Oxfam. The report's not produced yet, but what it does highlight is the issues and challenges for single parents in particular who are in higher education. And the research does show that although child poverty is a national priority with targets to cut child poverty, and that's obviously inseparable from parent poverty, that current policies don't address the educational needs of single parents and single mothers, in particular in higher education. So, for example, the Commission on Widening Access, which is a very important area because it supports those who want access that maybe don't yet have the kind of recognised qualifications. It was established to promote access to higher education for disadvantaged groups. It doesn't include single parent students, and they aren't mentioned in the report. And I think what the Oxfam report shows as well is the University of Scotland doesn't address the needs of the student group either. So I think there's quite a fair bit of work to be done on this proposed sort of promise, and linking it into lifelong learning as well. That's a real challenge to support single parents to access lifelong learning, and some of it's because of the UK benefit system and conditionality. But I know perhaps we might be looking at that sort of later.
Thanks for that, Marion. Conditionality and universal credit is very controversial. The UK government suggests it helps people into work and increase their earnings. Is there any evidence to suggest that the sanctions regime is having that effect? And what alternatives should be considered by the UK and Scottish governments to support people into employment? Just on that subject, I'll put it back to yourself, Marion.
Right, thanks. This is a huge issue for us, and conditionality and benefit sanctions has been something that we've done research on, we've lobbied on, we've tried to influence policy on, and in fact the Chancellor announced increasing the tightening up of conditionality on single parents, and they've changed the kind of earnings threshold from sort of 15 to 18 hours at the national living wage. So that means anyone working below this is going to be subject to stricter work conditions and, you know, the requirement to look, you know, for more work or to increase their wage. And you know, the past single parents, and you know, would have had limited or no work search requirements below this threshold, and they're now going to be subject to intensive work search requirements and the threat sanctions. And I know that through our service in Glasgow, we're seeing that some of that coming through, because that's one of the pilot areas. And we strongly would argue that sanctioning parents and the threat of sanctions changes behaviour, and actually it can impact on sustainable employment, because the threat of sanctions requiring single parents to move into work, a very work-first approach, they move into the wrong job, they don't have the right support or the childcare, and it falls apart. And that, you know, many single parents, you know, their sustainability and work is really challenging. So we think that this intensifies poverty, and we really wish the UK government would move away from this very work-first approach. It's not the right one for single parents. And we know from our work, our research, that disproportionately affects vulnerable single parents. And so they miss an appointment and they get sanctioned. And they end up, we have to take them to food banks because they've had their benefit cut. So a huge impact on employability. And it just adds to that crisis that families face that prevents them moving in and achieving what they want to achieve. Thank you.
Absolutely horrific. Thanks, Marine. Anyone else want to come in on that one?
Sorry, still not used to this button. I think just two very quick points on both your questions. So firstly, on priority groups, I think it's just to reiterate a point that a lot of witnesses made, you know, almost this time last year in response to Best Start Bright Futures. I think there is still a risk that the priority groups are a lens through which policy that has been designed in a catch-all way are viewed after the fact. So policies that are intended to catch everyone will be evaluated or looked at after the fact to then see, you know, how many lone parents, etc., went on to those, as opposed to being a lens through which we design policy. And I think that's a really important shift. If they are a group, if they are the groups we really want to tackle and really want to improve opportunities for, then you need to start your policy making by ensuring that those policies target them, whereas I think quite often we just look at them after the fact. And then in conditionality, I mean, there's lots of evidence to say that says, and we've done some and happy to share with the committee UK-wide, that suggests that it's still an incredibly punitive regime rather than supporting regime. Quite often it forces people to take, quite often it ratchets up underemployment, because people quite often take low quality jobs because that's the way that they're directed to. So I think, you know, Scottish Government has been absolutely right to kind of reject that model. I think there's a risk that you take that too far, and what you end up with is a passive cash, you know, cash transfer that actually, again, doesn't bring in that wider support that people need. So, for example, you know, you can completely reject conditionality within something like the Scottish Child Payment, whilst also ensuring that you've got a ready-made group of people there who very clearly could potentially benefit from wider support. So there's no reason why, whenever those people are provided the Scottish Child Payment, that that doesn't come with signposting or passporting to employability services, to childcare they might be eligible for, to wider benefits. So that's not just about, there's been a big debate around passporting kind of automatic payments and passporting automatically, you know, from Best Start grant to Scottish Child Payment and vice versa. That's incredibly important, but actually what I don't think we've done yet is nail passporting and signposting to those wider services that people could benefit from. So yeah, I think we can reject it. There's lots of evidence to say it doesn't work, and in fact it's harmful, incredibly harmful in some cases, but that doesn't mean that we don't ensure that kind of we use the social security system to enable people to reach those wider services and support.
Thank you for that. Anyone else before I hand back to the convener? David?
Just quickly, thank you. going back to the priority group bit and just to put it into a bit of context, we spoke, you know, no one left behind, the figures in the document talking about nearly 6,000 parents, 22% moving into work. Fair Start, 11,000 parents, 30% got jobs, 18% sustained. Fedcap, our own delivery, sitting at 30% into work and 26% sustained. So, good in terms of national averages, but not good enough, more that can be done. And I think we're demonstrating that it needs more of a focused approach to what parents need and how they can engage. And we also talk about two-thirds of children living in poverty have a parent in work. We still have a third, around about 80, in excess of 80,000, that don't have a parent in work. So it also puts into context the scale of the work and how we need to cover everybody here.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Jeremy and then I'll follow up with Katie. Thank you.
Thank you, Gavina, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I can just maybe develop that theme slightly further. And I'd be interested to know how might the approach to this client group differ compared to supporting those who are either unemployed or economically inactive? Do we need different approaches? And I'm happy for anyone to jump in and take that.
David?
Yeah. Hi, thanks, Jeremy. It's a great question. I think there's, you were talking about the how does it differ, but I think there's also some similarities. I think we have identified that, you know, we talk about no one left behind, but we know that, you know, there are, you know, a number of people just now, you know, we look at what 786,000 people in Scotland that are economically inactive. So we talk about, you know, unemployment being at record lows. You know, we've got more jobs than people looking for work. We've got more people in work. Sounds really positive, but we have nearly 800,000 people that are economically inactive, right? Some of which will be parents, students. 30% have got health conditions, and the only data that we get from that is that 80% are not looking for work. So up until this point, it's been, well, they're not looking for work. We don't worry about that. Now we need to understand why. So rather than being different, we're in the process of creating an innovative model that is for that pre-employment stage. It's not about employment. It's about whatever people need, what matters to them just now, and that can be anything. And I think I was in a forum the other week about the National Performance Framework. And this is, again, the challenge we've got, where we are trying to create a national inspirational framework that's aspirational as well. But the gaps just now, for some people looking at that, they're just so far away from it. And if we go in and we start talking about employability or, you know, progression too soon, they're just going to retract. So I think that we need this wraparound support service, as we said, that brings in what people need to get them to a stage where they then might be able to consider talking. I think this is the same for parents. And what we're trying to do at Fedcap as well is look at a model that isn't just programme contract based. Okay, you come in, you do your so many weeks, and then that's you. As a not-for-profit, we're looking to reinvest and create almost like a lifetime membership for people that come on our programmes. So we realise that things change on a day-to-day basis and that you don't need to go back to the beginning, but actually you can keep engaging, you keep getting access to support, that whilst you do progress, you've still got that ongoing support that will help you get to where you want to go no matter what happens. So I think what does need to change is this kind of eligibility. You know, so we look at economically inactive. We've supported 3,000 people in Scotland that were economically inactive prior to coming on our programme. We have, through that, supported 1,500, so 52%, into work within 12 weeks, which is incredible. Some of the things they talk about is the transport issue, the cost of transport, their health as being barriers. Some people in the 25 and below age group had said they were actually attracted to the programme because they wanted somebody to talk to. Now, this tells you the situation that we're in and the barriers that we're trying to address. So I think we need a situation where we had, sorry, out of those 3,000, 40% weren't eligible for the programme. So you imagine somebody with multiple barriers building up the confidence. Think a parent with everything they're experiencing just now, finding somewhere, reaching out to them and being told, I'm sorry, this isn't for you, and we need to then find you something else. Not suitable because they're not looking for full-time work. So we need something that there isn't that assessment, that, you know what, if you come to us, you need it, and we're here and we'll support you. And then we can move them on into existing programmes that are there. Thank you.
Thanks, David. I think Sarah and then Marion.
Thank you. So if we're talking about in-work parents in particular, then the local employability partnerships and the local authorities have been attempting to engage and support these parents since the end of 2019. I think there's certainly been lessons learned with regards to our perception of the parents' and the employer's response to the support that is available. And I think there was a perception that parents would be really keen to engage, as would employers, and that wasn't necessarily the case. Now, given that we had lockdown and the pandemic in the middle of that, we're a wee bit further behind where we would like to be with supporting those parents and the employers as well. But there's certainly been continuous improvement put in place with how we can engage with those parents and what we need to do to adapt to the needs. So simple things like pre-employment parents tend to have a bit more flexibility about their engagement with support staff and training. If you have parents who are working and they have caring responsibility for children, we need to think about the flexibility and when we are providing those support services. So that needs to be out with your 9-to-5 normal hours, needs to be out with your Monday to Friday type office hours. We need to look at the difference between evening provision and online provision that parents can potentially undertake once they've put kids down at night and things like that. So there's a variety of small tweaks and learning that has already been established across the country with regards to the motivation of parents that are in work and trying to support those parents as well. I think one of the biggest hooks for those parents, which is very similar to the pre-employment parents, is the financial advice that they can gain. So if we can potentially provide the carrot that is really good financial advice to make sure that parents in work are receiving all the benefits that they are entitled to, and also get a really robust calculation with regards to better off from work calculations, so that they can consider the best option for them that would, in real time terms, lead to an increase in household income, and not just be making this assumption that we increase hours, increase hours, increase hours, and that increases your income, because there's a lot that's lost because of that, then that seems to be the motivating factor that is similar across both groups as well.
OK, before I bring Marion in, can I just remind the panel that we're kind of running out of time, and we've still got two members who'd like to come in and ask questions. And if you can be more succinct and concise with your responses. Thank you. Marion, thank you.
Very much agree with what Sarah said on the local authority partnership approach. What I would say is that we would argue strongly that the approach to working with single parents is very different. Most single parents are women. Many of the parents we work with have had really challenging experiences. Many have split up from a partner who has been domestic abuse, including financial abuse. And through our services, we bring parents together, as well as providing one-to-one employability support. And through that, parents support each other. We think that's a really crucial ingredient. But we also use that as a model to co-produce our services with parents. So we involve parents in the services we deliver, and we have continual feedback from them on how we're doing. I also wanted to say, I know you want me to be succinct, but it's very important to recognise that in-work statistics are not the end result. I mean, this whole thing is about how employment can help reduce poverty, how it can help reduce child poverty in the target groups in the child poverty delivery plan. And like the latest stats are out show that where parents are in full-time work, single parents are in full-time work, 26% of their children are still in poverty. And that compares to two-parent families where it's 7%. So, I mean, this is a good piece of evidence to show that even in full-time work, it's harder for single parents to lift the family out of poverty. So they do need other support beyond employability interventions. And we've talked about sort of some of these. And I mean, we did some research recently, and one in five of the parents in paid work that they could, they find it really hard to afford food, that they could no longer afford it sometimes, and that they were eating their children's leftovers. Some of the, over half of them said the same about electricity and travel. So, like, you know, one parent said, I've had to leave a job, I can no longer afford the petrol costs. I use my work, my car for work too, so because of the rising costs, I've had to stop activities with my children because I need to pay for petrol. And then someone else that she can't afford to get the bus. She walks 6 to 10 miles a day to sort of get to the co-op where she gets the cheapest food. So, I think that it isn't any job. It's the job that is well paid and sustainable. Thank you.
OK, thanks, Maggie.
Thank you. I'm conscious of time, Queen, so I'm happy just to leave it there and move on to the next area.
Thanks, Jeremy. I'm now going to pass over to Katie, and then I'll bring in Paul. Thank you.
Thank you. And to pick up on one of the points that Marion made earlier, does the increased focus on parents affect the scale of provision that is being provided to other groups, or how other groups are being treated, for example, young people and disabled people? And I don't know if either Sarah or David would like to come in on that.
Sarah. I think we come at it from a different angle. We want to support everyone, you know. So I think ultimately, with the shift in funding and various layers, you know, going then in a while. I mean, I think I was at a local authority the other day, and I was looking at, you know, their budget allocation was anywhere between £2 and £3 million for parental employment, and between £300,000 and £500,000 for no one left behind. It doesn't make sense, you know. So maybe there's an opportunity that actually the local authorities then, if it's been devolved there, then have that money to deliver what they need in that area, rather than being, you know, predetermined as to what group. I think for us the only bit again is that we want to support everyone at whatever stage they're at to get to wherever they want to go, you know, not making any assumptions. And I think that there's a mindset change here, in that it's not as a provider, an organisation or an employer sitting here saying, you know, we will welcome anybody when they come to us. It's about how can we go out and be proactive and reach them and make sure they're aware of what's out there and what help they can get.
Yeah, I suppose what I'm asking is whether services are expanding or whether resources are just shifting. I don't know if Sarah would want to come in on that.
Hi, Sarah.
Thank you. I'm happy to come in on that. I think we need to be mindful of the work that goes into employability planning in local areas. The planning uses local data, and we have our own local priorities linked to CPP plans, child poverty plans, economic strategies at local level as well. So it's much broader than just the kind of funding that comes through No One Left Behind. I mentioned earlier that there is other investment in the area around employability. In the Forth Valley area in particular, we have Fair Start Scotland run by the local authorities, which means we can align and integrate services much better. UK Shared Prosperity Fund, the End of European funding. So, yes, there is going to be an impact because, as David suggests, if the funding that is targeted to a particular area increases significantly, then you do have to ramp up your resourcing capacity to make sure that you are meeting the kind of profiles and what is expected of you in the area. However, what we tend to do at local level is then we look at the planning as a whole, and we look at the other areas that are priorities, such as you've mentioned around disabled people, young people and such like. And we then look at the other provision that's available, and if we can tailor and we can mould and we can move things to make sure our priority groups that we've determined at local level are still being serviced through whatever funding is available or whatever provision and programme is available at local level. However, that differs quite significantly across local authority areas.
I don't know if any of the other panel would want to come in, but I could move on maybe to my final question, which is really to ask what extent parents are now the central focus of growth in employability activity, and that might be a suitable question for the IPPR, Philip.
Yeah. I'm going to say something I don't want to be taken as flippant. First Nurse Scotland was established in 2018, which is exactly the same year, you know, just after the Child Poverty Scotland Act was passed and the first year that the first Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan was published. So those two things came into, you know, existence at the same time. But despite that, all the evidence shows that parents haven't been a focus since the programme, since First Start Scotland was first established. Just a fifth of starts on First Start Scotland have been parents. So that's, not to be flippant, you know, kind of, no, of course they've not been a focus. But I think what you've seen there is that, again, despite the fact that the first Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan also recognised that employability was key, I don't think that's fed through into policy delivery and employability. So in terms of where the focus is now, again, just on the basis of numbers, so if you look at how many people First Start Scotland has supported since 2018 when it was first brought in, and compare that to the numbers that the Scottish Government has put in Best Start Bright Futures, absolutely the numbers that the Government wants to reach far outstrip the numbers that it has reached to date. Again, I don't think that has to mean a shift in resources or focus from other parents. I think Sarah's, you know, really articulate or kind of really well put the fact that, particularly with no one left behind at a local level through local employability partnerships, that, you know, they do take that really keen focus on who in our area needs support. But at a national level, you know, again, what that needs to come with is additional funding and additional resources to be able to follow through in that policy priority of meeting our child poverty targets and, as part of that, helping more parents into work and to increase their earnings in work. So, yeah, I hope that it doesn't have to be a zero-sum game or one or the other, but it absolutely requires a focus of resources to be able to deliver on that policy.
OK, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Paul, who... And that's the last of our questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and hello to the panel. And, you know, particularly interested, I think, in the relationships in this space in terms of how do we support employers. So IPPR in their submission have talked about using the government using soft power to try and encourage employers to really play their part. But I suppose there will be good tangible examples, and I'm maybe keen to understand from David, certainly, how do you engage employers into this?
Okay, thanks, Paul. So, yeah, I'd mentioned at the start, really passionate about this, as I'm sure everyone in the room is in a previous role, and FedCap are partners of the Scottish Government-funded public social partnership, and fully believe that we can support people, we can upskill people, we can give people dreams and aspirations, but if we don't have employers that are able or confident enough or knowledgeable enough in how to support those individuals, then the job's not going to work. So we have our own employer solutions team that go out and find employers that are recruiting, support them to support people that are, you know, with multiple barriers, whether it's disability, whether it's low payments, whether it's flexible working arrangements, etc. To date, we have worked with 5,000 unique employers, and we can deliver a range of things for them in terms of disability confident status and development. But I think the biggest bit is that this isn't just about putting people forward for jobs in any job. This needs to be the right job at the right time for that individual. Also needs to be the right person for the employer, otherwise they're going to stop coming to you. We have multiple relationships, but one with an organisation in Fife who came and said to us, you know, we do tech, we're really good at doing tech, we're really bad at recruiting. We now just come to FedCap and it works. And that relationship where the person, so a parent comes on our programme, they have their dedicated advisor, they have their dedicated health and wellbeing support, they have their in-work support, but you also then have our employer solutions team that do the matching, understand the individual's skills and wants, understand the employer's needs and wants, and only bring them together when it's right for both parties to ensure sustainability. But that relationship with employers is crucial.
Thanks, convener. I wonder if I can ask Philip just about the IPPR submission.
Oh, sorry.
Marion,
yeah,
and Sarah
on that
want
point.
To come
yeah,
in.
No, of course.
Thank you. Marion, thanks. Marion, can you hear me okay?
All right, okay. I just wanted to say that in terms of employers, that it is a crucial part of the jigsaw. And in the past, we had a really great programme with Marks and Spencers, and we had that as part of a pathway approach, and that we supported parents to engage with Marks and Spencers, and they did work experience in there, and then they had access to job vacancies as they came up. So I think sort of partnership approaches with sort of big employers, and of course there's some really big employers in the public sector as well. And you know, within the NHS, I know there's a programme as part of Northern Life Behind, which is engaging with the NHS. But I think we could do that on a larger scale, and I think through contracts that are given out through public sector, that there could be more of a focus on supporting those parents who are in the target groups. As Philip said, kind of actually keying in on those family groups to proactively encourage recruitment of those parents. Thank you.
OK, thanks. Can I bring in Sarah? Thanks.
Thank you. I'll try to be concise in just the variety of approaches, if that's okay. So within a local employability partnership, we have a variety of partners who have direct employer engagement. So you have Developing the Young Workforce and SDS, Business Gateway, Chamber of Commerce and such like. So we can all work together to ensure we are sharing those resources and sharing those relationships. Where we require an in with a particular employer for a particular reason or a particular participant. So that's one way of doing it collaboratively in partnership. We're in, suppose, the luxury position of being part of a local authority, that we can work with other local authority services in gaining opportunities for participants, and they tend to be well paid, good conditions, ideally placed for parents as well, and we can broker parents into those opportunities. So that's another approach we take. We work very closely with our colleagues in procurement to make sure that the community benefits and procurement clauses within contracts that are coming in, particularly big infrastructure projects, we are aligning modern apprenticeships or employment opportunities to not just parents, but young people in wider groups as well. And of course, we're continuously looking at where we can establish supported employment opportunities as well for participants, particularly with long-term health conditions and disabilities, and how we can support businesses who want to give back to the community. They want to support this, but how do they do that, and how do they best support individuals that may require some additional support in that initial transition into employment? So just to give a bit of a variety around the different ways that we engage with employers.
OK, thanks, Sarah. Can I bring in Paul? Can I make you aware that we are running over time? So
certainly,
to be as clear and concise as possible.
Of course, I'm just going to direct this question then to Philip. He did get a trailer just in the previous part. Just your recommendations in terms of that soft power piece, and I detected something about carrots and sticks, perhaps, about how we encourage the government encourages employers. So do you feel that those recommendations have been well received by government? Is there any progress on that, or do you think we need to do more to encourage those recommendations to be used?
Yeah, to be concise, we definitely need to do more, as we've got commitment to be a fair work nation by 2025. Don't really think that is yet very well defined in terms of what that means and what that looks like. To date, you know, a lot of this does come down to the devolution settlement, the power that government has. A lot of it is soft power. It's, you know, essentially marketing and PR through things like the business pledge and everything else. So I think there's a role for looking at what role the tax system plays, you know, what role the non-domestic rate system plays, things like that, that I don't quite think we've tackled yet. But more than anything, like, there is that role for businesses, like, you know, even under, you know, if you could imagine all employment powers being devolved to Scottish Parliament, you know, that's probably just doing all stick is not the way to do it. Like, there needs to be a carrot as well as part of businesses' ESG responsibilities. So, yeah, keep it concise. We are nowhere near to there yet. You know, if we want to be a fair work nation, again, however that's defined, in 2 years' time, then further work is going to need to be done, and that needs to be done by government and business.
Thank you, Kavina.
Okay, thanks very much. So that concludes our public business today. I'd like to thank all our witnesses for taking part and sharing their expertise. So we'll now move into private to consider the remaining item on the agenda. Can members who are joining us remotely please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting? And I'd like to say thank you to all our witnesses today. Thank you so much.